الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله لقد جاءت رسل ربنا بالحق وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بلغوا عني ولو آية. قابل احترام بزرگو بھائیو اور عزیزو، اللہ جل جلالہ ہمارے الہ ہیں، ان کے علاوہ کوئی الہ نہیں، اسی کے لیے عبادت ہے اور کسی کے لیے بھی عبادت نہیں، اسی کی یاد کے لیے نماز قائم کرنی ہے. اللہ جل جلالہ کا مبارک ارشاد ہے، بے شک قیامت آنے والی ہے، میں اسے مخفی رکھنا چاہتا ہوں، پوشیدہ رکھنا چاہتا ہوں، تاکہ بدلہ دیا جائے ہر ایک کو جو وہ کر رہا ہے. ہم سب رات دن کچھ نہ کچھ کرتے رہتے ہیں، ہر ایک کو اپنے کیے کا بدلہ دیا جائے گا.
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. اما بعد، my respected elders and brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is our ilah. He alone is our master, our creator, our owner. The ibadat that we do, none is worthy of worship and worthy of ibadat but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The salat that we have prayed, the salat that we establish, it is for the worship and the ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran the meaning of the verses that I have. Definitely the hour qiyamah is going to come, but I have kept it hidden away from the people, the real knowledge. I did not disclose it to the people, so that on the day of qiyamah, each and every one will be recompensed and be rewarded according to their actions.
ہر کام دو طرح کا ہے، ایک طرح کا اللہ جل جلالہ کو راضی کرنے والا، ایک اللہ پاک کو ناراض کرنے والا. دیکھنا، اللہ راضی کرنے والا بھی ہے، ناراض کرنے والا بھی. بولنا یہ بھی، سننا یہ بھی، لینا دینا، کھانا پینا، حلال کھانا بھی ہے، حرام کھانا بھی ہے. یہ سارے کام دو طرح کے ہیں، اس لیے ہمیں ہوش سے چلنا ہے. کیا کھانا ہے، کیا نہیں کھانا، کیا پینا ہے، کیا نہیں پینا، کیا دیکھنا ہے، کیا نہیں دیکھنا، کیا لینا ہے، کیا نہیں لینا، ہر ایک کو بدلہ دیا جائے گا.
Every action is of two types. Either it causes the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or it causes the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our seeing either causes the pleasure of Allah or the displeasure of Allah. Our hearing can cause the pleasure of Allah or the displeasure of Allah. Likewise, our tongues and the usage of our tongues, our speech can cause the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, our use of our hands, of our feet, our coming, our going, our dealings, everything that we do can either be a means of earning the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus, each and every one of us, we have to be completely and fully aware and alert with regards to our every action. Is it causing the pleasure of Allah, earning the pleasure of Allah, or the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Every one of us have to be fully conscious and aware with regards to our movements and our actions.
یہی باتیں سمجھانے کے لیے اللہ جل جلالہ نے انبیاء علیہ السلام بھیجے. سارے نبی ایک محنت لے کے آئے، سارے انبیاء علیہ السلام. اس لیے ہمیں اپنی زندگی نبیوں کے طریقے کے مطابق, یہ جو ہم جمع ہوئے ہیں محنت میں, رسول پاک صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کا مبارک طریقہ زندہ ہو. ہم کیا چاہتے ہیں, یہ اجتماع کس لیے ہے, یہ جماعتیں نکالنا یہ کس لیے ہے؟ محنت میں رسول پاک صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کا مبارک طریقہ زندہ ہو. نمبر دو, زندگی کے ہر شعبے میں نبی علیہ السلام کے مبارک طریقے عملاً چالو ہو جائیں.
So for this to be achieved and to realize this, that how, what is the effect of our actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam. That the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam came to the people and explained it to the people that with regards to that way of life and those actions which will cause either the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much so, even our coming here, our gathering, our making effort, our movement, the purpose behind all this is that one is that action and that activity and that effort of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that it must once again become alive, it must come into vogue. And then our whole way of life, every aspect of our life, our day-to-day activities, the different branches of our life, it must come according to, it must conform with the deen of Allah and the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is for this purpose that each and every one of us have gathered here.
انبیاء علیہ السلام کا مبارک طریقہ کیا ہے؟ نمبر ایک, لوگوں کے پاس چل چل کے جانا. نمبر دو, اپنی جان اپنا مال کسی سے کچھ سوال نہیں کرنا. نمبر تین, وہ کھول کھول کے بیان کرنا, سمجھانا سکھانا, اس پر چلانا. اتنے کام ہوتے ہیں نبی کے. نبی صرف ہماری طرح بیان کر کے اور پھر سو گیا جا کے, یہ نہیں ہوتا. جب تک امت کو اس پہ ڈال نہ دے, نبی محنت کرتے ہی رہتے ہیں, کرتے ہی رہتے ہیں.
So what is the way and the pattern and the system of the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam? There are three main and important characteristics with regards to the that the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam came with. The first from those three is that the Nabis went to one person. The Nabis went to their people, not leaving out anybody, no exception to the rule, but with the deen and the command and the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they went to one person. The second thing or characteristic in the way of the Anbiya is that the Nabi would go and he would utilize his own health, his own wealth for accomplishing this responsibility, not hoping for any reward or any praise or nothing in return from anybody. Completely selfless and full of worry and concern for the people that they were sent to. They would go to the people, utilizing all their energies, all the things at their disposal for the people. The third thing was that the effort of the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wassalam, one was they would explain to the people and openly show the people what is the correct way, what is the incorrect way, and put the people on the correct way of life, and imparting and educating the correct knowledge which came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that nation and for that ummah. So this was the way of the Anbiya. And in doing so, the effort of the Nabi who was sent to any of the nations and ummahs previously, that they would ceaselessly and constantly make effort. Not like us, that we might just give a bayan for 1 hour, 2 hours, and thereafter we will go our affairs and we will maybe be tired and we will sit down, we will relax. No, but the Nabi's effort is such, it is one which is constant, which is going on and on, without a moment for rest or for respite also.
اب محنت میں نبوی طریقہ, لوگوں کے پاس چل چل کے جانا, اس انتظار میں نہیں رہنا کہ جو آئے گا ہم سکھا دیں گے, جو آتا ہے اس کو بھی سکھاتے ہیں, جو نہیں آتا اس کے پاس چل کے جاتے ہیں. نوح علیہ السلام قوم کو دعوت دے رہے, قوم فرار ہو رہی, کانوں میں انگلیاں دے رہی, رات دن دعوت دے رہے. نمرود حضرت ابراہیم علیہ السلام کے پاس نہیں آتا تھا کہ جو اللہ نے آپ کو دیا مجھے بھی سکھاؤ. فرعون موسیٰ علیہ السلام کے پاس نہیں آتا تھا, جو اللہ نے آپ کو سکھایا ہمیں بھی سکھاؤ. ابو جہل, ابو لہب, عتبہ, شیبہ, یہ امام الانبیاء کے پاس نہیں آتے تھے, نبی ان کو دعوت دینے جاتے تھے اور رات دن دعوت دیتے تھے, جو آج ہم نے چھوڑا ہوا ہے.
And furthermore, one very, very important characteristics with regards to the effort of the Anbiya is what, that they would go to each and every person, not just waiting that those that want to know, those that want to be enlightened, those that want to be educated, that they will come and we will impart to them and then they can go on. No, those that used to come to the Nabis with some desire, the Nabi would direct them also and give them direction, educate them also. And many, many, many who did not even have this desire, that Nabi would go to them also and instill in them that necessary desire to take from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, it is said about him that by day also he used to go to the people, by night also he used to go to the people. The more he went to the people, the more they used to flee from him, run away from him. They used to put their fingers into their ears so that the words of his message must not fall into their ears. But despite all these challenges, this is not deter Nuh alayhi salam. He continuously went to those people by day, by night, for weeks, for months, and for years. He did not wait for anyone to come to him only. Likewise, Namrud, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam did not wait that Namrud must come to him. Those that came, but other than that, the people, the likes of Namrud and his likes, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam went to them. Musa alayhi salam, he did not wait for Firaun to come to him, but he was sent to Firaun and he went to Firaun. Likewise, in the time of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the peoples of the likes of Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Utbah, Shayba, all those people, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not wait for them to come to him, to come into his presence and to take from him and to learn from him. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would continuously go to them regularly all the time and impart the deen and the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with regards to this very, very important characteristics, with regards to the effort of the Anbiya and our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is one very, very important feature that every one of us, we have become unmindful about and we have overlooked.
Mehnat mein Nabi alayhi salam ka tariqa zinda ho, usme پھر یہ ہے, سب سے پہلے ایمان و یقین قوی ہو, اس پر محنت کرتے ہیں انبیاء علیہ السلام. اس لیے ایمان قوی ہوگا تو عمل قوی ہوگا, ایمان کمزور ہوگا عمل بھی کمزور ہوگا, ایمان بالکل نہیں ہوگا عمل بالکل نہیں ہوگا. یہ ہے طریقہ. عبادت اعمال وہ کرے گا جس کا ایمان قوی ہوگا. مثلا ایک ہندو کو کہو نماز پڑھ, سکھ کو کہو قرآن کی تلاوت کیا کر, یہودی کو کہو نبی علیہ السلام پہ درود شریف پڑھا کر, انہوں نے کیا کرنا؟ جس کا ایمان ہی نہیں ہے اس نے عمل کیا کرنا؟ جس کا ایمان قوی ہوگا, جتنا زیادہ قوی ہوگا اتنا ہی اس کا عمل قوی ہوگا.
The other important thing to keep in mind is that by making the system of effort of Nabuwat alive, what is the first demand and dictate is that the effort for the rectification and the strengthening of a person of one's iman and yaqeen, a person's faith and conviction with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that unseen system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The important thing to remember is when the iman and the yaqeen become strong, then those actions which will come out from that person's body, now that will become strong. His life will come on a'mal. When the iman and yaqeen with regards to Allah is weak, then those a'mal also will be weak. Furthermore, that person who does not have any iman and yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what amal can come out from that person? If you tell a non-believer that to make salat, that if he makes salat, of what benefit is that salat? Salat is not being directed to him. He does not even have that necessary iman and yaqeen to pray that salat. Likewise, you tell another non-believer, a person who does not have iman, that you recite the Quran, make tilawat of the Quran. What tilawat of the Quran is going to make? You tell another person who does not have iman that you recite durood, send salat and salam on Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What durood is he going to send on Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he does not possess the necessary iman for that also? So the underlying point and principle to keep in mind is that when iman is there, iman is strong, then the a'mal which will come out will be strong. When the iman will be weak, then those a'mal which will come out from a person will likewise be weak.
عبداللہ بن عمر رضی اللہ عنہما کہتے ہیں حضرت عمر رضی اللہ عنہ کا ایک باغ تھا اس کو دیکھنے کے لیے گئے واپس آئے تو عصر کی جماعت ہو چکی سلام پھر چکا کہنے لگے انا للہ و انا الیہ راجعون میری تو نماز کی جماعت نکل گئی میں تمہیں گواہ بناتا ہوں میرا یہ باغ مسکینوں پر صدقہ ہے وہ باغ 200,000 درہم کا بکا اس کی قیمت یتیموں مسکینوں پہ لگا دی گئی ایمان کبھی ہوگا باغ چھوڑے گا نماز کی وجہ سے عمل کی وجہ سے ایمان کمزور ہوگا عمل چھوڑے گا باغ کی اور چیزوں کی وجہ سے
حضرت عبداللہ بن عمر رضی اللہ عنہما he says that حضرت عمر رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ had one orchard. On one occasion he went to that orchard to look or to tend to the orchard, and in doing so when he returned he saw that he had missed the Asr Salat with Jamaat, that he became so sorrowful, he was filled with remorse and regret, that he said, it because of this orchard or this well that I possess, that I lost out on one great action, the virtue of praying my salat, with my Asr Salat, with Jamaat. Therefore, that I'm declaring that this orchard garden of mine, that it must be sold, and whatever that comes, it is derived from there, it must be given to the poor people as sadaqah and as charity, as khairat. This, the value of this was 200,000 dirhams of that time. This, nonetheless, it was sold, and all the monies, it was distributed amongst the poor people. The point that is being made is that when a person's iman is strong, then necessarily those a'mal will be strong. That Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu's iman was strong, then he was prepared to forfeit that expensive garden and orchard for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, when the iman is weak also, then what will happen? The a'mal that will come out will also be weak, and as a result, then a person for the most smallest of material gains also, that he will forfeit a'mal, he will forfeit salat and the likes of it, all for the sake of mal.
Sa'id ibn Musayyab Tabari hain. کہتے ہیں 40 سال میری تکبیر اولی فوت نہیں ہوئی اور 20 سال کوئی اذان ایسی نہیں ہوئی جس میں میں مسجد میں نماز پڑھنے کے لیے پہلے نہیں آیا 20 سال نماز پڑھنے کے لیے اذان سے پہلے مسجد میں پہنچے اذان بعد میں ہوئی محمد بن سماع کہتے ہیں 40 سال میں میری ایک مرتبہ تکبیر اولی فوت ہوئی جس دن ماں کا انتقال ہوا تھا اس کو کفن دفن کی وجہ سے تکبیر اولی نکل گئی اس طرح ایمان قوی ہوگا پھر اعمال قوی ہوں گے
سعید ابن المسیب is a famous تابعی It is said about him that he said that for 40 years continuously that I did not miss my salat with Takbir-e-Ula. And from that 40 years, 20 years are such that I was in the masjid before the azan went. That he was the first person to enter into the masjid. 20 years lapsed like that. Muhammad bin Samak, another great scholar, it is said that he also said that for 40 years I prayed my salat continuously with Takbir-e-Ula. In those 40 years, only on one occasion, I missed my salat, not with Jamaat, just the Takbir-e-Ula. Jamaat was prayed with the salat, but the Takbir-e-Ula was missed on that occasion when my mother passed away and I was occupied with her burial, etc. That was the only time in that 40 years that I missed my Takbir-e-Ula. So the point is that when iman is strong, then those a'mal that will come out also will be strong and good.
Makkah Mukarramah mein قرآن پاک کی وہ آیتیں اتری ہیں جن سے ایمان قوت پکڑے. احکام عبادات یہ مدینے میں آئے ہیں, مکے کے اخیر میں نماز آئی ہے. مکے میں وہ آیتیں اتری ہیں, وہ چیزیں اللہ نے بیان کی ہیں جن سے ایمان قوت پکڑے. اللہ پاک کرتے ہیں, اپنی قدرت یہ بتائی ہے. سب سے اخیر میں مکے کے اخیر زندگی میں نماز آئی ہے. روزہ مدینہ منورہ میں جا کے فرض ہوا. زکوٰۃ مدینے میں. حج سن 9 ہجری مدینے میں. حدود اور قصاص یہ مدینے میں. شراب کی حرمت, جوئے کی حرمت یہ مدینے میں. پردے کے احکام یہ مدینے میں. مکہ مکرمہ میں جو قرآن اتر رہا تھا اس میں کیا تھا؟ احکام تو مدینے میں. مکے میں وہ آیتیں آ رہی تھیں جن سے ایمان قوت پکڑے.
If we have to examine, we will see that all those verses which were revealed in Makkah Mukarrama, the subject matter of all those verses will pertain or are connected with those matters by which a person's iman and yaqeen will take root and will become strong. Only towards the end of that Meccan period, or Makki period of life of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in other words, in that, towards the end of that time, then only from the first amongst the injunctions, the commandments, was salat. That came right at the end. After that, in Madinah Munawwara, then the different commandments and injunctions which came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it came after Hijrat in Madinah Munawwara. The fasting which came in Madinah Munawwara, like that. All the other ahkam, all the other commandments in Madinah Munawwara, the prohibitions with regards to drinking, with regards to gambling in Madinah Munawwara, the ahkam with regards to parda, that also in Madinah Munawwara, with regards to the hajj, that also in Madinah Munawwara. So if we have to examine, we will see that all the subject matter of those verses and surahs which were revealed in Makkah Mukarrama were of such a nature that to that it enables the person's iman and yaqeen to become strong.
اب میں کچھ مکی صورتیں, اس میں کیا اتر رہا تھا. قرآن کہتا ہے افرأیتم ما تمنون, جو تم صحبت کرتے ہو یہ اس سے بچہ تم بناتے ہو کہ ہم بناتے ہیں. اب بتاؤ جو تم کھیتی بیج ڈالتے ہو, کھیتی تم اگاتے ہو کہ ہم اگاتے ہیں. یہ جو اب بادلوں سے پانی برستا ہے یہ تم اتارتے ہو کہ ہم اتارتے ہیں. یہ آگ جلاتے ہو, یہ تم نے درخت پیدا کیا کہ ہم کرتے ہیں. مکے میں اس قسم کی آیتیں آ رہی تھیں.
So we might ask that what are the subject matters of those verses of Makkah Mukarrama. For example, amongst those the subject matter of those verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directs the attention of people towards his qudrat and his power. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when husband and wife meet and the sperm which comes out from there, Allah ta'ala says that the ability to bring life from there, and for a human being and a child to be born from there, that did you do it or did we do it? That seed that you put into the ground, you place into the ground, did you cause it to grow or did we by our qudrat cause it to grow? Likewise, the clouds that are moving and bringing down rain, did you cause it or did we do it by our qudrat? Likewise, the fire that you are utilizing for your different needs and purposes, that spark which brought that fire, is it us that created it or is it you that created it and made it? So these are the types of verses Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in Makkah Mukarrama.
أَفَلَا يَنظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. یہ مکے میں آ رہا ہے.
Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that أَفَلَا يَنظُرُونَ, that do you not see that this camel, how it has been created, ponder over the creation of this camel. فَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ, and how it lifts its head up to towards the skies. And in this way, the mountains, that how we have created the mountains, who kept them firmly planted into the earth. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the earth, how we cause it to spread out for the benefit of human beings. Who created it? Who made it in this way? These are the subject matters of the Makki verses.
اللہ الذی, میں وہ آیتیں بتا رہا ہوں جو سورتیں مکے میں اتری ہیں, اس میں احکام نہیں ہیں. وہ اللہ جو کرنے والے ہیں اپنی قدرت, وہ بتا رہے ہیں میں کرتا ہوں. اللہ الذی خلقکم من ضعف ثم جعل من بعد ضعف قوة ثم جعل من بعد قوة ضعفا وشیبا.
So I am explaining to you those type of verses which were revealed in Makkah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the attention of the people towards His Qudrat, and everything is in His hands, everything is in His control. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for example, in this particular verses, that it is Allah who created you, and when He created you, you were weak, then you became strong. That also by the Qudrat and permission of Allah. And after your strength, when you became old and weak again, you were overtaken with old age and weakness. All these are those type of verses to instill in a person about the greatness and the power and Qudrat of Allah.
اللہ الذی خلقکم ثم رزقکم ثم یمیتکم ثم یحییکم هل من خالق غیر اللہ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse, Allahu alladhi khalaqakum, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created you from nothingness. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who sustains you and feeds you. And it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who will grant you life after death has overtaken you. These are also the type of verses.
یہ مکی صورتیں, سبح للہ ما فی السماوات والارض وہو العزیز الحکیم.
And likewise the different surahs of the Makki surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ, that everything which is in the heavens and in the earth, they make the tasbih, and they hymn the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala is all powerful, Allah is all wise.
لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتِ وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ.
That for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ownership and the sovereignty of everything in the heavens, the earth, and everything in between. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His Qudrat who gives life. It is Allah by His Qudrat who gives death. Everything is in the control and under the decree and decision of one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Makki surah mein yeh hai.
In the Makki surahs, this is the subject matter.
هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ.
That huwa al-awwal, Allah is the first. Huwa al-akhir, Allah is the last. Allah ta'ala is apparent, Allah is hidden. Wa huwa bi kulli shay'in alim, and Allah has knowledge over each and everything. These are the type of verses of Makkah.
Huwa alladhi khalaqa as-samawati wal-ard fi sittati ayyam. Wo Allah, ye Makkah mein aa raha.
Likewise, Allah Ta'ala says, it is one Allah alone by His Qudrat who has created the seven skies, the seven heavens, the seven earths by His Qudrat alone in 6 days. This is the subject matter of the verses of Makkah Mukarrama.
Ye sari surah Al-Hadid padh lo, tarjuma dekh lena. Sari surat Allah ki azmat, uski badai. یہ بیان ہو رہی ہے.
Likewise, this type of surah, for example, surah Hadid, also the few verses which were recited, that from the beginning till the end, the subject matter is with regards to bring the attention of the people towards the greatness, the glory, and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
اللہ الذي يرسل الرياح.
That it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another verse, اللہ الذي يرسل الرياح. It is one Allah alone who sends the winds by His قدرت.
وهو الذي ينزل الغيث من بعد ما قنطوا وينشر رحمة.
And it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who causes the rains to come down after people gave up hope. Allah ta'ala sends down His rahmat and His mercy in the form of the rains.
Ab sara Quran Pak hamare paas maujood hai.
So the whole Quran is in front of us.
Jis aadmi ko Quran par amal karne ke liye tayyar karna ho, uska tarika yahi hai ke pehle wo baatein unse karo, وہ باتیں ان سے کرو جن سے ایمان قوت پکڑے. ये बातें करनी.
So for this person whom we want that he must start moving and coming onto the deen and adhering and practicing on the deen, then initially, in the initial instances, what we should do in the start is to instill in that person, like the subject matter of the Quran with regards to Makkah Mukarramah, these are the type of the subject matters that we have to instill and impress upon the person so that he can his iman and yaqeen can draw strength from with regards to these type of verses wherein the greatness and the qudrat and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned.
Iman hoga, haram na hoga.
When there is iman, then there will be no haram.
Iman nahi hoga, phir haram hoga.
When there is a lack of iman or absence of iman, then haram will come into vogue and into existence.
Iman bhi ho aur haram bhi ho, ye nahi hoga.
That there is iman also and haram also, this is not conceivable.
Iman aadmi ko haram khane nahi deta, haram peene nahi deta, haram dekhne nahi deta, haram lene nahi deta, haram dene nahi deta, ye iman hai.
Iman is such, it is such a thing that it will not allow a person to look at haram, to hear haram, to speak haram, to give haram, to take haram. This is the power and the strength of iman when iman is present.
Hadith Pak mein pehle ummaton mein ek waqia bayan kiya. Ek aadmi ne zameen bechi, dusre ne khareed li. Khareedne wale ne paise de diye. زمین والے نے زمین کا قبضہ دے دیا.
It comes in a hadith, one beautiful incident is narrated that in the previous nations there were two people. One was selling his plot of land and the other was purchasing that plot of land. The transaction took place that the buyer, he gave over the money and the person who was selling the land, he handed over the plot of land to the buyer.
اب خریدار نے زمین میں کام کرنا شروع کیا.
The purchaser of the land, he began working on that land.
اب کھدائی شروع کی, نالیاں بنانا, جو بھی کرنا.
And he started digging and to make the canals to look after that land.
اس زمین میں سے سونے کا بھرا ہوا گھڑا, مٹکا, وہ سونے کا بھرا ہوا نکل آیا.
So whilst he was busy digging, he found that he came across one place, that one whole earthen pot or jar filled with gold coins. He discovered that while he was digging.
Usne socha, maine to zameen wale ko zameen ke paise diye, ye ghada sone ka bhara hua, iske to maine paise nahi diye, isliye ye mera haq nahi hai. Zameen bechne wale ke paas gaya. آ بھائی یہ دیکھ گھڑا سونے کا بھرا ہوا نکل آیا میں نے تجھ سے زمین خریدی ہے یہ سونا نہیں خریدا اس کو اٹھا اور لے جا.
So the person who purchased the land, when he came across this big container of gold coins, he thought that, he said to himself, when I purchased this land, it was without this gold coins, it was not part of the transaction. What he did, he went to the seller of that land and he explained it to him that when I bought this land from you, that this gold coins, it was, I was digging, I came across this whole container of gold coins that was not part of this bargain and transaction when you sold it to me. Therefore, please, you come and you take this whole container of gold coins and take it for yourself. It is yours. It does not belong to me.
Zameen wale ne kaha, bi'tul arda wa ma fiha. میں نے اسی حال میں تیرے ہاتھ زمین بیچی ہے, تجھے زمین دکھا دی, یہاں سے یہاں تک یہ اس حال میں بیچ دی, اب یہ میرا حق نہیں ہے. اب زمین سے پتھر نکلے گا, کنکر نکلے گا, کوئی لکڑی نکلے گی, جس حال میں زمین تھی میں نے اس حال میں بیچ دی, اب یہ میرا حق نہیں ہے, یہ تیرا حق ہے. اب دونوں راضی نہیں, گھڑا سونے کا کروڑوں اربوں روپے کا, لیکن وہ کہتا ہے میں نے اس کے پیسے نہیں دیے, میرا حق کیسے. وہ کہتا ہے میں نے اسی حال میں بیچ دی, جب قبضہ دے دیا تو اب میرا حق نہیں رہا.
So now when the purchaser, he explained to the seller that this is not mine, this is your right, I bought the land. The seller, he is saying that when I sold you the land, I had the intention that I am selling this land and whatever is in this land. And in the land, when a person sends the land, I explain to you that this is the perimeter, this is the measurements and the dimensions. So whatever is in this land, it is yours. I made the intention. And when a person buys the land, there are stones also, there are boulders also, there are other things which are lying on the ground also. Therefore, my intention when selling was that whatever is on this plot of land, it is yours also. Therefore, it is not my haq. I cannot take this haq. It is not my right. The person who bought it, he's saying it is not his haq. The person who sold it say it is not my haq, it is your haq, you take it. Both are quarreling with one another and trying to prevail over one another to take their haq. No one is ready to do so.
अब दोनों काजी के पास चले गए. हम भी जाते हैं अदालतों में हुक्मरानों के पास. वो कहता है ये मेरा हक है, दूसरा कहता है मेरा हक है, फैसला करो. वो अपने दलाइल देता है, वो अपने देता है. ये दोनों, ये भी काजी के पास गए. काजी जी, ये मेरा हक नहीं है. मेरी दलील ये है कि जब मैंने कब्जा दे दिया, अब मेरा हक कैसे हुआ. वो अपनी दलील दे रहा, काजी जी मैंने इसके पैसे नहीं दिए, मेरा हक कैसे हो गया. काजी भी मुसलमान था, ईमान वाला था. ईमान बंदे को पटड़ी पे चढ़ाता है. ध्यान से सुननी है ये बातें. ईमान बंदे को पटड़ी पे चढ़ाता है. हाँ, काजी भी ईमान वाला, वो भी नहीं ले रहा, ये भी नहीं ले रहा, तीसरे किसको दे. अगर काजी ईमान वाला ना होता तो फिर काजी कहता अच्छा तुम दोनों लेने को तैयार नहीं हो तो हम किस लिए बैठे हैं, ले आओ, मैं तैयार हूं लेने के लिए. हम इसको किसी दीनी काम में लगा देंगे. काजी भी ईमान वाला, ईमान होगा हराम ना होगा. हराम तब होगा जब ईमान ना होगा या ईमान कमजोर होगा. काजी ने कहा अब तीसरे किसी को तो दे नहीं सकता, वो तो साहिब मामला है ही नहीं. करो तर्जुमा.
सो इवेंचुअली दीज टू पीपल नाउ दे सेड ईच एंड एवरी वन, बोथ ऑफ देम, ईच वन सेइंग इट इज नॉट माय राइट, इट इज द अदर्स राइट. दे केम टू अ डिसीजन, लेट अस टेक इट टू द जज. Like we might go to the lawyers or to the judges or to people to arbitrate our cases. And what is the condition or pitiable state of affairs when we go to this type of people with regards to our matters? The person who he will give all his proofs and say it is my right, it is my haq. And the opposite party also will put all his proofs forward and say it is my haq. These two people, they go to the qazi and each one is saying that this is the situation. The person who bought it says, I bought the land, but I did not pay for this container of gold coins, this treasure. It is not mine. The seller, he is insisting and he is saying that when I sold this land, that I sold it with the intention that everything on this land, it is not mine, it is his already. The Qazi, he also, he was not one whose iman was questionable. He was also sound on iman. He was strong on iman. And this is what we have to learn, is when iman is such a commodity, iman is such a thing, that it takes a person to such great heights and such high levels of iman, of Allah Ta'ala's fear, Allah Ta'ala's consciousness. So what does he do? It's not that he says, he did not say, because iman was sound and strong. If his iman was weak, and this is the point, we must appreciate that when iman is strong, then there will be no haram. When iman is absent, then haram will come into vogue and haram will start spreading. So what did this qazi, this judge, what did he say? He did not say, not yours, it's not yours, it's mine, you leave it to me, I will dispose and I will use it how I want to. He did not say this because his iman was of such caliber and such strength also.
Qazi ne kaha, एक से पूछा तेरी कोई औलाद है, उसने कहा जी हाँ बेटा. दूसरे से कहा तेरी कोई औलाद है, उसने कहा जी हाँ बेटी. काजी ने कहा इन दोनों का निकाह कर दो और ये सोना इन दोनों को दे दो.
सो हाउ डिड द काजी डिसाइड? ही आस्क्ड द वन, डिड यू हैव एनी चिल्ड्रन? द वन सेड यस, आई हैव गॉट अ सन. ही आस्क्ड द अदर पर्सन, डू यू हैव एनी चिल्ड्रन? दैट पर्सन सेड, आई गॉट अ डॉटर. The Qazi decided that fine, that you make them get married, make the nikah, and this whole container of treasures, you hand it over to them.
Ab ye sona, दोनों कबीलों के आपस में रिश्तेदारी कराबतदारी का सबब बन गया.
So this gold which was being disputed, each one denying that it is his right, the Qazi with his sound judgment and decision, it became the means of two families and two tribes getting together and being united and bonded.
अब मैंने अपने आप से पूछा, तुम अपने आप से पूछो, मेरी दरखास्त है आप सारे अपने आप से पूछो.
Now I am requesting each and every one of you sitting here. I always ask myself and address myself also. I am requesting you also that each and every one of you, I am going to pose a question to you. You look at yourself and you ask yourself.
आप अपने आप से पूछो.
Ask yourselves.
अब आदमी को अपना हिसाब लेते रहना चाहिए. हासिबू कबल अंतु हासबू.
Why? Because each and every person must take stock and account of them of themselves by themselves. Like it comes in a hadith that take stock and take account of yourself before a time comes when account will be demanded from you and you will have to give.
आदमी जा रहा हो वो देखता रहता है कि मैं सही जा रहा हूँ या गलत तो नहीं जा रहा.
A person is going somewhere, moving in a certain direction, that does he ask himself that I'm moving in the correct direction or an incorrect direction?
अब मैंने अपने आप से सवाल किया.
So I asked myself,
अगर तू जमीन खरीदने वाला होता, सोने का भरा हुआ घड़ा निकल आता, मैंने अपने आप से पूछा, आप बोल के बताओ अपने आप को, तू क्या करता?
So we let us ask ourselves now, just for a moment, let us stop now and ask ourselves that if we were the buyers of that plot of land and whilst we were busy, we came across this huge container of gold coins, what would we have done? What would I have done?
मेरे दिल ने बोला.
So my heart answered my question.
कि मैं उस बेचने वाले के पास जाता, उसको कहता भई ये तेरा खजाना है, ले ले.
My heart tells me that I would take this container of gold coins, I would go to the seller and I would place it in front of him and tell him that, brother, this is yours, it belongs to you.
क्योंकि मेरी माँ ने हमारे ऊपर बहुत मेहनत की थी.
Because the reason for this is that my mother made lots of effort on me.
फिर मैंने दूसरा सवाल किया अपने आप से.
Then I asked myself the second question.
मेरे के अगर तू जमीन बेचने वाला होता, तुझे जमीन बेचने वाला ये कह देता कि भी ये मेरा हक नहीं है, बेतुल अर्द बमाफिया, मैंने ये सारा बेच दिया, ये तेरा हक है, मेरे ऊपर हलाल नहीं है, ये तेरा हक है, फिर तू क्या करता?
The second question, a bit more difficult, I would have asked myself, now once I took it to the seller of the land, and I would tell him that this is not mine, it is yours. And he in reply would tell me that I sold the earth, that plot and everything in it with that intention. So it is not mine, it is yours, you take it. So the second question is that what would have been my response and my reaction?
Mera dil bola. Phir jab wo keh deta ke ye mera hak nahi hai, ye tera hak hai, tu hi kha pi. Mera dil bola. Phir main kehta dil dil mein, ये गैबी मदद है. हम आखिर तबलीग में जाते हैं, अल्लाह ने गैबी मदद कर दी, काजी के पास ना जाता.
So he says,
तुम अपने आप से पूछो.
So the second question now. Now if we have to ask ourselves that if the seller would have said to us that, you know what, I sold this land and everything in it, it is not mine, it is your hak, I don't have any hak on it, my intention was everything on this plot of land, so you take it. Now I must ask myself, let us ask ourselves, now what would have been my reaction, your reaction, our response? What from the heart, what would the reply come now? We would say then that, look, this is coming from the seller now. This is from Allah. This is Allah's help. I go out in Jamaat, I go 40 days, I go 4 months. So Allah's unseen help has come to me. It is mine also. We don't have to even go to the Qazi. Why go to the Qazi?
Phir maine dusra sawal kiya apne aap se, aap bhi apne aap se karo.
Then I pose another question to my heart and I want you people also to put that question to yourselves.
Agar tu zameen bechne wala hota, wo kehta khareedar, मैंने इसके पैसे नहीं दिए, ये मेरा हक नहीं है, ये तेरा हक है, तू ले ले, मैंने तो पैसे ही नहीं दिए, ये तेरा हक है. फिर मैंने अपने आप से पूछा फिर तू क्या करता, जवाब वही है, फिर मैं कहता ये गैबी मदद है अल्लाह ने की है, ये ठीक है ले लेता।
Now let us just reverse the role that if we were the sellers and the person who bought the land came to us and he said that I bought this plot of land, this gold coins, it is not mine, it does not belong to me, I did not purchase it with that intention, it is yours, he's telling the seller. And had we been the sellers, now ask ourselves this question, what would have been our response and our reply? It would have been the same. What? That this is the help of Allah that has come. I did not have to go to the Qazi, I don't have to go, because he's insisting it is mine. It is Allah's help coming to me, unseen help, therefore it is mine now.
Phir maine teesra sawal kiya.
Then I asked my heart the third question.
Agar tu Qazi hota, wo bhi nahi leta, phir tu kya karta?
So I asked myself the other question now, that if every one of us was the judge or the Qazi and this matter came to us, each one insisting that it is not my right, he is saying it's not my right, me as the judge, what we would have done?
Jawab wohi hai, phir main kehta, acha tum dono nahi lete, to hum kis liye baithe hain, le aao.
And what would have been the reply? Very similar reply, you saying it is not yours, for what reason are we sitting here? I am sitting here, you people go, no one wants it, I am sitting here, I will utilize it.
Kyunki zindagi banana maal se bachpan se chala aa raha hai, tum apne aap se sawal karo, apne aap se, har koi apne aap se sawal kare, tumhare paas wo sone ka bhara hua ghada aata, tum kya karte, apne aap se poocho, maine to apna bata diya.
Because from childhood we have been indoctrinated and it has been firmly embedded in our hearts. What? This idea that our lives will be made on the basis of mal. If there is mal, then our lives are made. Each and every one of us ask ourselves under this particular set of circumstances, what would have been our condition and our situation?
Mal se zindagi banne ka agar yakin ho, ye banda sahi chal hi nahi sakta.
That if a person does not have that correct conviction and yaqeen with regards to the fact that life cannot be, is not dependent on the possession of things, this person will not be able to move ahead or gain or make any movement in the correct direction with regards to his deen.
Hazrat Isa alayhi salam ja rahe the, 3 aadmi saath aur ho gaye.
Hazrat Isa alayhi salam was going to one place. 3 people saw Hazrat Isa alayhi salam and asked permission to accompany him, gave permission and they began accompanying him.
Aage sone ki do eentein padi thi.
Whilst they were traveling, they came across 2 bricks of gold.
Isa alayhi salam ne kaha, yahi duniya hai, log ladte marte hain, unko nahi chheda, uthaya hi nahi aur seedhe chalte gaye.
Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, when his gaze fell on that bricks of gold, he said, this is that dirty dunya for which people are fighting and doing what not to acquire this dunya. He did not even bother but continued with his journey.
Hazrat Isa alayhi salam nahayat dunya se beraghib insaan the.
Hazrat Isa alayhi salam was such that he was completely detached from the dunya and the things of the dunya.
ये तीनों आदमी सोने से जिंदगी बनती है, इनके दिल में ये यकीन था।
On the other hand, these 3 people who accompanied Hazrat Isa, what was the conviction of their heart? That if one's life is made and if a person wants to become successful, it will be through mouth, wealth and things. This was the condition of their iman and their yakin.
थोड़ी दूर जाके हजरत ईसा अलैहि सलाम से कहने लगे, हमने तो उस तरफ जाना है, हमारा रास्ता उधर है।
So they continued going a little while ahead with Hazrat Isa, but this was troubling them, so they made some pretext and excuse, and they told Hazrat Isa that actually we have to go on another road in another direction, not in the direction that you are going, you continue.
और वहां से पीछे मुड़ के ईंटों के पास आ गए, नबी को छोड़ दिया सोने की वजह से।
And what they did eventually was they made a U-turn and they headed back towards the direction of that goal. They made a U-turn, leaving the way and the path and the company of a Nabi for that low bricks of gold.
Eenten do hain, hum bande 3 hain, kaise taqseem karein?
Now there are 2 bricks of gold, 3 people, how are they going to divide the booty?
Ek bola, पहले दोपहर खाना खा लें दोपहर का, फिर तकसीम करेंगे.
So one from the three, each one is also, his mind is operating now. One gave an opinion that let us eat first. After we eat, then we will worry about the distribution, how we are going to distribute.
खाना कौन लाएगा? एक बोला मैं लाता हूँ.
Someone said, who is going to fetch the food? One person volunteered, got ready. He said, I will go and get it.
खाना लेने चला गया.
He set out to go and get the food.
ये पीछे दोनों ने मशवरा किया.
The two who remained behind, they began making mashwara.
ईंटें दो हैं, हम तीन हैं.
That we are three and there are two bricks of gold.
क्या ख्याल है तेरा? जब वो आए उसको दोनों मिल के मार दें, एक ईंट तू ले ले, एक मैं ले लेता हूँ.
So one told the other, now that what do you have to say, that there are two bricks of gold, we are three, it is difficult to divide. What do you say that when he comes back, the two of us get together, we sort him out and finish him up, kill him, and then there are two of us, two bricks of gold, one for you, one for me.
दूसरे ने कहा बेहतरीन मशवरा है.
The second said, this is the best advice and mashwara.
दूसरा जो रोटी लेने गया उसका यकीन भी सोने से जिंदगी बनने का था.
The person who went to go and buy the food or fetch the food, his yaqeen was also on this basis that if life is made, it is made on gold, on silver and the different material things.
उसने सोचा अगर मैं खाने में जहर मिला के ले जाऊं, उन दोनों को जहर वाला खाना खिला दूं, दोनों को मार दूं और ये दोनों ईंटें मेरी.
So what plot he made? He said that there are two bricks of gold, we are three. I will take some poison, put it in the food. Once they eat that food, they will fall down dead. And then I've got two bricks of gold for myself.
खाना लेके आया, दोनों खड़े हुए, उसको मार दिया, फिर खाना खाया, वो दोनों भी मर गए, ईंटें उसी तरह पड़ी. शाम को ईसा अलैहि सलाम आए, देखा ईंटें पड़ी हैं, इर्द-गिर्द तीनों मरे पड़े हैं.
So when this person came back with the food now, laced with the poison, these two were waiting for him. When he came, they pounced on him, they finished him up. Now when they finished him up, they said, now we can eat what haram now, we can take our time, eat, seeing the dreams also about the gold. As one person lying dead, they ate the food, both of them also died. By evening, when Hazrat Isa was returning from the journey, he saw that there are three corpses and two bricks of gold.
आज सारी दुनिया का फसाद, उसका उसके वजह सबब गलत यकीन है. सोने से जिंदगी बनेगी, माल से बनेगी, ये पहाड़ हमारे हैं. वो कहता है मुल्क वाला, मुल्कों की लड़ाइयाँ, ये पहाड़ हमारे हैं, ये खिता ज़मीन का ये हमारा है, ये खिता हमारा है. सारी दुनिया की लड़ाइयाँ फसाद, उसकी वजह गलत यकीन. अल्लाह जिंदगी बनाएगा इसकी बजाय माल से जिंदगी, सोने से जिंदगी, चांदी से जिंदगी, पैसे से जिंदगी. हर चोर चोरी इसलिए करता है, डाकू डाका इसलिए मारता है, कातिल कत्ल इसलिए करता है. बाप बेटे की लड़ाई, भाई भाई की लड़ाई, ये गलत यकीन की वजह से है.
So my friends and brothers, all the madness and all the confusion in this world, the basis of all this madness, all the confusion, all the killings, all the maimings, it is of only on one account, that each and every person has understood that if life is made, if a person wants to acquire success, then it is on the basis of the acquisition of things. A person will have gold, he will be successful. A person has silver, he will be successful. A person has money, he will be successful. A person has huge plots of land, he will be successful. The more he has all the things, he will be successful. So the reason for all this confusion and all this chaos and all the corruption, it is this. From individual to individual, person to person, country to country, one claiming, one a person steals because he wants that success, it is on the basis of that incorrect yakin. A person is a robber, it is on the basis of this incorrect yakin that my life will be made with wealth. Governments fight with one another that this piece of land, this tract of land, this mountain, it belongs to me. That one claims it is belongs to me. And upon that, countries upon countries, peoples and nations, they all are fighting. And the fundamental reason and cause for all this is the incorrect yakin that our lives will be made and we will be deemed as successful when we have all these different material possessions by us.
इसलिए हमारी गुजारिश है, जिस तरह हमने आज दुनिया की चीजों को अपनी जरूरतें बनाया हुआ है, अरे ये छोटी जरूरतें हैं।